some for some a particular form of supraventricular tachycardia. And I would like to start with a clinical case. Let's see the first slide. She is a 45-year female with hypertensive history, symptomatic for episodes of palpitation, 4 to 6 episodes a year, lasting from minutes to hours. This episode have a sudden onset and termination, and I'll show you in the next slide the first EKG recorded during the first admission in our emergency room. Unfortunately, waiting cardiological consultation, this lady has a spontaneous cardiolation in a sinus rhythm. So I start to show you the EKG recorded during the tachycardia. Could you see the EKG?
I think all people should see ECG, yes.
So I have a question. What is your interpretation about this EKG tracing? We can postulate different hypotheses. The first one is a supraventricular tachycardia with a narrow QRS with a frequency of 140 beats per minute. We can say is an orthodromic atrioventricular entrant tachycardia, first possibility. The second one is an atrioventricular nodal reentrant tachycardia. The third possibility is an ectopic lateral tachycardia, or related to the frequencies, about 150 beats per minute, is an atrial flutter with 2-to-1 AV conduction. What is your opinion about this EKG?
Okay, so ladies and gentlemen, you have now possibility to answer this MCQ. Please vote what is your preference and try to be involved, all of you, because this is important that you are involved.
Well, to have more information, unfortunately, we need to have some information how the basal EKG. But that it was the EKG recorded at in the emergency room.
Okay. Would you like to comment, Fiorenzo, on this result? Interesting.
It's interesting because about the majority of people say is an atrioventricular nodal reentrant tachycardia, and the 40% say an orthodromic atrioventricular reentrant tachycardia.
I'm actually a little bit surprised because I expected that most people would be more correct. I'm surprised by the first choice because there is, to be honest, not much clue to say that.
I agree with you, but one possible reason is the fact that they can't compare the EKG in sinus rhythm and during the tachycardia. Now you can see the difference between the two EKG. In the left, the EKG, D1 amplification, looking well the sinus rhythm, the QRS, and the D1 during the tachycardia. Focus your attention on this retrograde P waves, recorded, like positive in V1 and negative in the inferior leads. So we can say there is a retrograde activation, is a concentric activation because is negative in the inferior lead, very close to the QRS. That means from the EKG, we have the possibility to say in the, with a range of right answer of 99% that is a atrioventricular nodal reentrant tachycardia.
Yes.
There are some questions about that from the audience. So waiting for some questions.
If I can just say a short comment, it emphasizes the need for 12-lead ECG because from Holter, usually you may not have such a detail as in all leads, like we saw here in lead V1 is very important, or lead 3, to diagnose, for instance, this entity. So every time you have a tachycardia, you should have a 12-lead ECG, and this is the best for diagnosis.
Absolutely. Another point in favor of the diagnosis is all of the clinical history. She is a female, 45 years old, and that means rare that you can be symptomatic for AVRT at this age. From the when you have a female and the first symptoms start at the age of 40 years, the first thing what you have to think is a nodal supraventricular tachycardia.
Exactly.
Well, I would like to share with you the history of atrioventricular nodal reentrant tachycardia. The first hypothesis regarding the existence of two functionally distinct pathways connecting the atria and the ventricles coming from Mainz in 1913. But we have to wait until 1956 when Moe provided the first evidence of functional longitudinal dissociation within the AV node, describing the presence of a fast and slow pathway in a dog model. And we have to wait still to 1963 when Dennis first described in humans the presence of dual nodal physiology. What I mean is like dual nodal physiology. Using the techniques of premature extrabeat during an atrial pacing, you can measure the interval between the the AH interval. You can see in the, we try to go with our draw, you can see the my pointer.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Josette.
Yes. Yeah, I see the pointer. Everybody should see it.
When we stimulate with an A1, A2 ranging from 800 to 450 milliseconds, you see a progressive increase of A2, H2 interval. And then suddenly, we have an increase of conduction with an A2 increasing from 120 up to 400 milliseconds. That was the first demonstration in humans of dual physiology in AV node. A more recent example recorded for you in my lab yesterday, you can see the during an atrial pacing with an AA of 600 milliseconds, we do an atrial extra beat of 340 milliseconds of prematurity, and the AH interval is 282 milliseconds, reducing just a little the coupling interval from 340 to 330 milliseconds, we can see the prolongation of AH, what we call jump, and the A2H is 400 milliseconds. So a dual AVN physiology can be demonstrated in about the 90% of patients with the clinical documentation of atrioventricular nodal reentrant tachycardia. But the question is typical this dissociation only in patients with symptomatic for AVN RT, or how many subjects within general population do you believe have a dual AV nodal physiology? So my question is, what you think about that? We are speaking about patients without history of palpitation, normal patients who receive an AP study for other reasons, like ventricular tachycardia, atrial flutter, or so on. What is the percentage of AV dual physiology? About the 10 to the 20%, about the 30 to 40%, 50 to 60% or more, 80, 90%.
This is an interesting question. If we are talking about a population that undergoes EP study for different arrhythmia, it could still be some duality in some of them, so it may a little bit over-exaggerate real occurrence in asymptomatic patients who never undergo EP study. But it's an interesting question. I wonder how many people will vote for what percentage of cases.
When we started, you remember, we think that it was typical for AVN RT patients. So the majority of people give an answer is present between the 30 and the 40% of people without AVN RT. That was, if you want it right, if we have problem with the mouse. Okay. We move to the correct answer. The correct answer is 80-90%, but it's also correct at about 30-40. I try to explain to you why. In the first study from Danis 1965, Costa 1998, the percentage of dual AV nodal physiology was recorded in about the 15-35% of patients. In 1993, WHO first demonstrated the double nodal curve in the total population, 90% of patients study, but look the difference. In the cases of Dennis and Costa, the study was performed without sedation, while in the WHO work, there is a heavily sedation during the study. That could explain the difference. We come back to the work of Dennis. Look what happened about the presence of dual conduction in AV node. If you do the study in the basal situation, you can see with the triangle, the black triangle, you can clearly demonstrate the dual conduction, while if you introduce isoproterenol, you can see the disappearance of dual conduction. What happened? The isoproterenol increased the conduction in the fast pathway, masking the slow pathway activation. So, for this reason, if you do the research of dual nodal activity in normal situation, you can find that in about the 30% of patients, but if you are used to use a heavy sedation, like do Sonny Jaquan. Sonny Jaquan, when he do EP ablation, NDP study in his patient use a very heavy sedation. And in this case, in the majority of patients, you can find a dual AV physiology. That is too much important because we have to take in mind, to focus in mind, that dual AV physiology is normal. is not a marker of EBNRT. So when you study a patient and you find a dual AV conduction, that does not mean is equal the presence of EBNRT.
This is important because sometimes people cannot induce any tachycardia and they see duality of AV nodal conduction and they ablate without having diagnosis. So this has to be emphasized that it is quite normal physiology. So you should have some more information about arrhythmia before you start ablating this dangerous area.
Absolutely agree with you. We don't perform ablation if we don't have documented a clinical arrhythmia of patients. Because if you have only palpitation, you do your EP study, you see you can demonstrate the dual nodal activity, and we can have a wrong attitude to perform a slow ablation saying the symptom of patients are related to EBNRT. In a large part of this situation, you are not so good results. But we come back to the reentry circuit in atrioventricular nodal reentrant tachycardia. You know that reentrant rhythm involves the presence of two distinct pathways, with a zone of slow conduction and unidirectional block in one arm, one limb of pathway, allowing that an electrical impulse to travel down to the second limb and re-enter to the block pathway from the other direction. The reentry circuit in AVNRT usually involves two anatomical distinct pathways showing different electrophysiological properties. The slow pathway with longer conduction time and shorter effective refractory periods, and the fast pathway with shorter conduction time at longer effective refractory period. I tried to show you in a draw what happens during the normal sinus rhythm. When the sinus rhythm arrives, the rhythm when arrives to the AV node is conducted to the ventricle through the fast pathway. So we record a normal PR interval. I apologize, there is a problem in the draw. There is a glitch in the conduction of slow pathway, the red pathway. Okay? If you have a premature atrial impulse, and if this impulse arrives when the fast pathway is still refractory because the refractory period is longer, the activation comes through the slow pathway, and that is shown in EKG by a long PR. And if the conduction is so longer that the impulse could come back to the fast pathway to the atrium, we can record the atrial echo as we can see during the tachycardia. And that's what happened during the arrhythmia. The impulse in the typical form of this arrhythmia go down from the atrium to the ventricle through the slow pathway and come back to the atrium through the fast pathway. For this reason, the retrograde activation is very close, is inside or very close to the QRS in the EKG. We can describe three different forms of AVNRT, the typical form, what we call also slow-fast form, using the slow pathway like anterograde limb and the fast pathway like retrograde. And that represents about the 90% of all the form of this arrhythmia. Then a very rare form of tachycardia, which we call atypical or fast-slow, using vice versa the fast pathway like anterograde limb and the slow pathway like retrograde. And in about the 9-10% of avian RT, the fast pathway is not involved in the substrate of arrhythmia, but the reentrant circuit is localized in two slow pathways. We can see quickly some example. This is the classic EKG of the typical form. In this form, as I showed you before, the retrograde P could be inside the QRS in about the 45% of cases, visible immediately after the QRS in about the 50-55% of patients, and sometimes very rare before the QRS. It's important to distinct from form of reentrant, including an accessory pathway, the timing between the R and the P prime. Generally, in the typical form, there is a time inferior to 80 milliseconds, equal or inferior to 80 milliseconds. This is an example of a typical form. You can see well the interval between the R and we try to show you with our pointer, the RP1 is very long, while the PR is quite normal. It is interesting to look for the typical morphology of this, of the P waves in this tachycardia, with the negative morphology in the inferior leads. Usually there is an equal number of P and QRS in this kind of arrhythmia.
Fiorenzo, can I ask a question for the participants? This is a very typical picture, but it could also be some focal atrial tachycardia from a lower aspect of atrium, or it could be PJRT, which means some accessory pathway with slow conduction. So can you maybe emphasize what is the differential diagnosis of what they should do in these cases to be sure that this is atypical AVNRT?
We start with the first one, the easier to answer, about PJRT. PJRT is a permanent Johnsonian reciprocal tachycardia, is related to the presence of an accessory pathway localized in the most case very close to the os of coronary sinus. This pathway has a long conduction, so the EKG picture is absolutely the same than in presence of form of atypical AVNRT. The only main difference is the clinical history. PJRT starts from the, when you are born and is permanent. In the majority of cases, you do an Holter monitoring and you find only few minutes in sinus rhythm, and the majority of time during 24 hours the patients are in tachycardia. Are reported a few cases of permanent Johnsonal tachycardia, not permanent, but only paroxystics. The second point is an ectopical atrial tachycardia. And you can try, if from the HCG, to differentiate this form of tachycardia, atypical or ectopic, using some little tricks. The first one, if you have the patients you are made the EKG, you can perform a vagal maneuver like carotid sinus massage. In a typical form on in PJRT, you have an interaction of tachycardia and sinus rhythm. Vice versa, in the ectopic ulcer tachycardia, you can see, you can block the V node and you can demonstrate more atrial activity and less ventricular activity. I can show you that with an example. go ahead. This is a form of atypical. We go ahead. We spend a few minutes to remember you that AVNRT is the most common form of paroxysm and supraventricular tachycardia, more frequent in female than in men, with a ratio of 2-to-1, more frequent between 30 to 50 years, and usually is not associated with structural heart disease. The episodes can last from few seconds to several hours. Generally, is a regular rapid tachycardia with abrupt onset and termination. The symptom more common is palpitation and dizziness. Less common is dyspnea or weakness. Angina or syncope is very, very rare. This is back. We come back to the clinical case. Alors, we have seen the patients during the tachycardia. Now we can see the patients during a spontaneous sinus rhythm. And she's feeling better, but we have to decide what we have to do in this young lady. What we do in this lady? We need an EP evaluation for better identify the arrhythmia, the substrate of arrhythmia, and we do directly to ablation. We can propose a pharmacological treatment with different drugs for working on AV node, like beta blockers or verapamil or diazepam. Or we can use drugs of class 1C and 3, like flecainide, sotalol. We can try to use only the vagal maneuver, like Valsalva maneuver or so on. Or we can suggest to this lady the therapy with the pill on the pocket, not using the drugs that we won't use, and above all, drugs then can work on the AV node, like beta blockers and verapamil. What is your choice of therapy? Don't forget, she is a lady, 45 years old, and she has 4 or 6 episodes for a year. AP evaluation. I think the majority of our audience are young electrophysiologists. So me too, do that 20 years ago. When I found patients like this, I was very happy because I can try to demonstrate if my interpretation of the EKG was right, and then to try to understand better and give the best results to my patients. Now it is a lot changed. I do this work from about 30 years, and so I am a little less aggressive. And in our institution, the first therapeutic step is to use vagal maneuvers. I suffer myself from AVNRT from 20 years. I can remove my AVNRT above all when I have it is related to the distress, above all when I have to speak in English in USA. With 3,000 people looking my slides. Sometimes I have AV nodal reentrant tachycardia. I do a little Valsalva, the tachycardia disappear, and I never perform in myself or my patients in this situation, AP study or ablation. So I suggest when you have a patient with a clear demonstration of AVNRT, as you, Joseph, showed, say before, this EKG was really typical. That is typical for presentation. The first one, the first therapeutic step is represented by vagal maneuvers. Vagal maneuvers, that was a work of my old chief, Professor Brusca, that showed me the results of vagal maneuvers in a different form of arrhythmia. You can see in sinus tachycardia, you can demonstrate a reduction of frequency. Vice versa, both in AVNRT and in AVRT, we have or the interruption of arrhythmia or no modification. We can use also that to demonstrate very well the atrial tachycardia, topic atrial tachycardia, as we have discussed before, is the E-panel. I try to come to the E-panel with my arrows. And you see what happened during the ectopic atrial tachycardia. You have, you can demask very well the atrial activation, creating a transitory AV block, while during AVNRT, the, you have, if you do well the maneuver, interruption of tachycardia. It's interesting for our patients to say, when you suggest maneuver, vagal maneuver, you have to do that immediately, at when the tachycardia starts. Because if you do that after 5 or 6 minutes, there is an increased adrenergic tone, and the vagal maneuver has not more enough. If you are not able to interrupt the tachycardia with the vagal maneuver, we go ahead, if you can. We have a little problem, okay. We can use a lot of drugs working on the AV node. The most used is the adenosine. But if you don't have adenosine in your country, we can use verapamil, diltiazem, some beta blocker like metoprolol, propranolol, or esmolol. F is ineffective, but that is very, very, very rare. You can repeat the vagal maneuvers. So what we have to do in this patient in a long-term treatment?
Maybe can we a little bit discuss this issue? I fully agree that it depends on a patient presentation, and if it's a first or second presentation and you see the patient should be informed about vagal maneuvers. But what we do, we discuss openly with the patient what it means, that the tachycardia is not life-threatening. They may fear that this is something very dangerous, so you explain them what happens. What is the tachycardia nature, and we also tell them, okay, you have several possibilities how to treat this arrhythmia. If you don't want to have this fear that it can come back again, we can do ablation, but it may have some complications. The complications are really very low in experienced hands. It's much below 1%. Or you can take drugs if you want, or you can do vagal maneuvers. And if the patient agrees, we do ablation, but we don't force them. But of course, we offer them even after first manifestation what are the options. The most important is to explain patient what is situation, and somehow give him opportunity to decide what he or she usually she wants. Do you agree with this, or is it too much aggressive?
Absolutely. Look at the slides. We do absolutely the same. We suggest a vagal maneuver. We reassure the patients about the benignity of this arrhythmia. And then we propose to the patients other choice. We can choose the pharmacological therapy and or ablation. In our experience, the majority of patients prefer to choose ablation. But we have to speak up with the patients also about the little risk related to the ablation. And so we can discuss about that. Now we are right to start with the AV NRT ablation. The majority of ablation, the historic ablation, start always by surgeon. The first ablation was made by a surgeon, Ross, working in Australia, with first demonstrate that was possible to cure AV NRT without damage the node, preserving the normal AV conduction. Starting from that, the electrophysiologist try at the end of 1989 to perform a selective catheter ablation of fast pathway. You know, we know that the fast pathway is very close to the AV node. So the idea was, if we put a catheter in a zone where I can record a little is a good atrium, if we perform ablation in this zone, we can destroy the retrograde limb of typical tachycardia. So this is the classical position of catheter. You see the catheter on the east, the ablation catheter AC. This is the zone where is generally performed the ablation of the fast pathway. And you have another catheter in the coronary sinus and the right atrium. What you look for? You try to have your catheter a very large atrium and a little is deflection. The procedural endpoint was a PR prolongation, at least 50% of PR, this means we destroyed the fast pathway and the contraction now is through the slow pathway. And that means a longer PR. The demonstration of elimination of retrograde fast pathway and above all the not inducibility of arrhythmia. But unfortunately, this kind of approach, very easy to do, you don't need a lot of experience to do that, is correlated to a very high incidence of complete AV block. And you don't have to forget that we are speaking about a benign arrhythmia, young people, young ladies. So you can achieve a percentage of success in about the 90% of your patients, but you have to pay a very high price, 10% of complete AV block. For this, you have also to remember this kind of ablation is not effective in this form of slow AV NRT. And for this reason, in about the 10% of cases, you don't achieve the good results. For these reasons, in 1992, were proposed three different approaches for selective ablation of slow pathway. But in reality, if you look well, the idea don't come from Yazzaheri, Issacher, Gaeta, or Jackman. But the first knowledge comes from an old work of Sung. He was the first in the world in 1981. He published the work in 1981, but he implied about 6 years to publish this work because all the electrophysiology at this time was disagree about the interpretation of Dr. Sung. Focus your attention in the panel A. During a ventricular stimulation, you can record the retrograde atrial activation, the earliest retrograde atrial activation. The first activation is recorded in the catheter on the east bundle, as attempted. So the conduction is through the fast pathway. The fast pathway is localized very at the top of the triangle of Cox, as you can see in this draw here. But Dr. Sung had the opportunity to see a jump in the panel B. Now the conduction is not more through the slow path, through the fast pathway, but through the slow pathway with a very long HA interval, 310. And look where is now the earliest atrial retrograde atrial activation. It's recorded from the catheter in the coronary sinus. It was the first in the world showing that the fast pathway and the slow pathway have two different atrial insertions. The fast in at the top of the Cox triangle close to the insertion of this bundle, and the slow pathway very close to the os of coronary sinus. Starting from this idea, from this observation, 5 years later, we can move our, okay, we move your attention for slow pathway ablation in a completely different zone with a completely different target. In the same period, 20 years ago, were proposed three different types of selective ablation of slow pathway. An anatomical approach proposed by Yazzaeri, and two different electroanatomical approach proposed by Michele Seghere and myself, and Sunny Jackman. I spent a few seconds to show you the difference of these three approaches. The first one, the anatomical approach. We can move a computer. Was made anatomically. I start to explain you what Yazzaeri proposed. You put your catheter in the zone of the Cox triangle. I mean, in the inferior part of the tricuspid ring, very close to the ostium, the inferior part of the ostium of the coronary sinus. You look for an electrogram characterized by a large, voila, we have, you can divide it, the zone of a tricuspid ring in three zones. The P zone, the M zone, and the anterior zone. P is the posterior, medium, and anterior zone. So you can move, like you can see with the catheter. First you do a linear ablation in the P zone, moving from the tricuspid annulus to the coronary sinus. If you can still induce the tachycardia, you move up the catheter to the mid-zone, and then if you have still tachycardia, you have to move your catheter to the A-zone. But if you arrive at this point, what you think, Joseph, is very stressing both for patient and above all for electrophysiologist, because you know this is the zone of very close to the compact AV node.
Yes, I agree.
Okay, what we proposed at this time, 20 years ago, with together with Michele Seghere, this is a low view at 45 degrees, we record this strange potential, which we call a slow potential, and we try to use this potential like a marker for ablation of slow pathway. And we achieve a very high percentage of success in 90% of our patients with without in this paper, without a risk of complete EV block. Sonny Jackman try identify another kind of potential that we call a sharp potential, preceding recorded very close to the host of the coronary sinus and preceding by a little atrium. And with the same results, performing radio frequency ablation using this with the potential as a marker, he received a percentage of success very high, more than 99% at zero AV block. Please focus your attention in this radioscopic view, we recorded in these patients both the potential, the slow potential in red and the sharp potential in blue. And you see how closer are the two potential, a few millimeters from one to each other. Remove. I try to demonstrate also the exact position of this potential using the more modern 3D reconstruction. In yellow, you can see the is recording. In green is the zone of compact AV node. In blue, the zone of slow potential. You can see the slow potential in the recorded in this magnification of the leads, and the sharp potential in pink. Well, the zone that we use both for anatomical or potential guided ablation is the zone very close to the between the coronary sinus os and the, the tricuspid ring. There was a question this time. What are the means of this potential? And Maguire is a clever EP electrophysiologist working with the surgeon. He performed a high density mapping during surgical ablation of AVNRT with a high density mapping. He showed the zone of a compact AV node and where you can record the slow potential. You look, you can record the slow potential everywhere in the zone between the coronary sinus up to the zone of a compact AV node. Vice versa, the sharp potential recorded by proposed by Jackman was recorded lower. At this time, he says the slow potential is a band of nodal type cell close to the tricuspid annulus and may represent the substrate of slow nodal pathway. And until now, the majority of good electrophysiologists thinks that the AVNRT, the circuit of the AVNRT, a part of circuit is not included in the compact AV node. The only ones that disagree with this idea 20 years ago was Mark Josephson, showing some cases of a very rare dissociation between the tachycardia and the atrium. We try to understand something more. We first try to convince all the people that the tachycardia was outside the AV node, but 10 years ago we have the opportunity to perform this anatomical dissection in a patient with congestive heart failure, treated five years before his death congestive heart disease, but with the AVNRT ablation, and look at the results. The site of ablation in red is localized in that Becker call the posterior insertion of the compact AV node. So presently, I think, also if the majority of test books is still reported that there is a part not very well identified of the circuit outside of the AV node, I think that Mark Josen was right, and the circuit or the slow pathway is represented by the posterior input of the AV node. As you can see in this draw, the posterior in the black, you can see all the compact AV node. You can see the posterior coming from the coronary sinus in this zone and the mitral ring in this zone, and the posterior part of a V-node arrives to the bottom of the coronary sinus. So,
can I have a question here? This question from one of the participants regarding recording of these potentials. The question is, which high pass or low pass settings do you use to identify the slow potential and the sharp one? That's a question from participant. Can you answer?
300. And depend also, we are trying to work a lot 10 years ago about that, depend also from the EP lab that we use. At the beginning, when we move from the analogic system to the digital system, we have a problem to recognize this potential. But too much important is to do together an anatomical and potential approach. What I mean? We have to look for this potential in the zone close to the coronary sinus and the tricuspid ring. And you have to look from the very close vicinity of the atrium to the slow potential. Because if you move a catheter up versus the roof or versus the tip of, towards the tip of a Cox triangle, you move your catheter close to the zone of a compact AV node. Also in this zone you can demonstrate a slow potential, but in this case the slow potential is far from the preceding atrium and closer to the ventricle. So when we do ablation using the slow potential, first of all you have to use the anatomical approach. What I mean, you have to put your catheter in the posterior zone, and what I show you in the 3D map, very close to the coronary sinus, you have to look for a big ventricle and a little atrium, and look in this zone for the presence of a slow potential. Using that, using the radio frequency, you can achieve the success with the one maximum two radio frequency burst. Other question?
Yes. Okay, can I have one more question regarding indication for ablation from your clinical case? Because there are a few questions from participants. I don't want to let them wait for a long time to answer the question. So one question is about your clinical case. If the patient has a history of these several episodes per year, and it's repeatedly, so she was probably taught about vagal maneuvers. So isn't now time to go for ablation in that case?
Absolutely. The only doubt is she is a patient with hypertension. If you have to treat hypertension, you can use beta blockers to treat hypertension. If you use beta blocker, in the majority of patients, you cure also AVNRT. If the patient has 5 episode years and the vagal maneuver is ineffective, no doubt the majority of people with AVNRT have also the value of the pressure low and don't tolerate beta blocker or verapamil. That is the main reason of the main development of the AVNRT. We perform a lot of AVNRT ablation. But it's important also to know there is other situation. In this patient, at the end, we have performed ablation. But we have explained also the patients that have the possibility to treat with only one drug, beta blockers, both hypertension and AVNRT. We treat this patient with beta blockers. And also with beta blockers, she still have AVNRT. For that, at the end, we perform ablation.
One more question here is, how about a patient with history of palpitation without ECG documentation? On EP study, there is no tachycardia induced, but dual AV nodal physiology demonstrated with 102 echo beats. Would you go to ablation or or you will just wait until it's recurrent and do ablation on second occasion. So it means if you have dual AV nodal physiology, you have documented a palpitation but not the ECG documentation of arrhythmia, and you have one or two echo beats.
Hello. Without echo beat, no ablation. If you have two echo beat, it's the patient is very symptomatic. The patient is on the table, and he has demonstrated minimum two echo beat. I discuss with the patient, saying, I am not so sure to cure your symptoms because you do ablation for a VNRT to cure symptoms. Unfortunately, we have never documented your symptom. If I have a preceding documentation of the VNRT, I can induce a VNRT, no doubt, I do slow pathway ablation. But if I have never recorded one clinical tachycardia, I suggest to the patients to wait until one record, because in my experience, a lot of patients come back for a second opinion after an unsuccessful ablation. The unsuccessful ablation was related to this the choice to perform AVNRT slow pathway ablation without documentation or induction of AVNRT.
Okay. So that's all for now, and I will come back again with questions. So you can continue now your talk.
We move from the epistudy. What we have to look during the epistudy? You have to rule out the presence of an accessory pathway, starting with the ventricular stimulation. Then you have to demonstrate the anterograde dual AV nodal physiology with the jump of the clinical arrhythmia induction, or other sign like the, what we call the K sign. That means you have during the vent kickback point a PR interval greater than ventricular interval. And also, I show you an example of that. If you have some rare case with 1-2 ventricular response, I show you an example of that.
Can I comment, Fiorenzo? You call this a K sign. We came to the same just by observation. We found that this is the best actually trick how to induce AVNRT and also how to test the efficacy of ablation. We call it we cannot stretch this in front of previous QRS complex the PQ interval, and this is for us one of the best tests for this for induction of tachycardia and also for testing after ablation.
So this is an example of, I completely agree with you, Joseph, absolutely. This is an example of jump and induction of nodal tachycardia. You can see in green all the electrogram as recorded above all at the same time with the QRS, and this is the typical form. Okay. Go ahead. And this is a case in whom you can also show a retrograde double ventricular lateral conduction jumps. You see with an interval of 340, the VA interval is 150, and with 330, the interval is 280. It's rare, but you can find that in about the 10% of our patients. You look for the Venkeback point. Okay. And you try to see the K sign. I'm not so sure that it's very clear, but look the interval between AA and in blue the RR interval. And you can see that the preceding atrium that stimulates the ventricle precedes the also one ventricle. That means that the PR interval is greater than the RR interval. It's more interesting, but very rare. I would like to show you that because it's not so easy to see. what we call one-two response. You see, we are stimulating the atrium. You see in blue the X activation after a normal AV interval, and then another X activation follows the red arrow. That means the blue means the activation through the fast pathway. Then there is a very slow conduction through the slow pathway, and the same atrial activation produce two ventricular activation, one from the fast pathway and the second one to the slow pathway.
This is very nice example, actually. This is not very often you can see this phenomenon. But if I can go back maybe to that chi sign, the best way how to do it, you just do incremental pacing and you watch your pacing stimulus. If you can get in front of a previous QRS complex, you can bet that you can always induce this AVNRT. Even after ablation, you cannot induce by program stimulation. But if you can do this and you can see this sign, it's always the slow pathway is there and it can always maintain AVNRT.
Absolutely agree with you. We do the same, absolutely. So, the last question. Which are the endpoints of slow pathway ablation? First one, not inducibility of AVNRT. The second one, abolition or modification of dual AV physiology. What do we mean like modification? Prolongation of refractory period of slow pathway and abolition of echo beats, of at least one echo beats. Disappearance, what you say just a moment before, of K-sign, or all of them. So the majority respond, no, that is bold. Hello?
Yeah. I think well, people but are still voting.
The right answer is all of them, sure. I would like all to spend the last few minutes to show you what we have to look to avoid complication. During ablation, we have to look for Johnson arrhythm. Johnson arrhythm are identified by the presence of is bundled before, without atrium, before the atrium and the ventricle activity. Johnson arrhythm is present in about the 95% of site of effective ablation site, but also, unfortunately, in about the 60% of non-effective ablation site. But it's too much important to focus your attention in that. When you see during ablation or a Johnson arrhythm without a retrograde conduction to the atrium, as you can see in the first one is a Johnson arrhythm with look the coronary sinus. You have a coronary sinus in green and the ventricle in blue, and you have both. In the second one, you have the ventricle without a retrograde activation of atrium. This means you are produce an injury of fast pathway of compact AV node. And you have to stop immediately the radio frequency ablation. We can go out. We show you only the last question. How often do you expect AV nodal block to occur after slow pathway ablation? in a less than 1% fourth answer, less than 3, sorry, first answer 4%, second 10%, third 2%, for less than 1%. Joseph, we have still time, or I have to try to close with...
We are a little bit over time, so we maybe should...
We can stop with the next two slides.
We can answer questions from participants.
Okay. Allora, I show you the results of the majority say less than 1%. Me too, for a lot of time I was agree with this idea because the results of the best center was less than 0.5, but look what happened in this paper published in the American College of Cardiology in 2009. A meta-analysis in 4,000 patients, the presence of block is very high, 1.7%. So we stop here and we wait for questions.
Okay, so... this was great, and there is one question about this K sign. You see it more frequently than ablation of jump or dual AV nodal physiology. If I can answer, yes, indeed, you can see it more frequently than complete ablation of dual physiology. But in our hands, it's a very good sign. If you can still see this sign, you can always induce AVNRT. If you can't see it, even though you have some dual AV nodal physiology, you may be okay, and the patient may not have any arrhythmia. So we always look at this sign first.
Absolutely, I agree with you.
Yeah.
If you have nothing, no inducibility, no dual activity, the probability of success is 99%. If you have still duality, the possibility of recurrences is about the 5%, but it's better 5% of recurrences than to you move the catheter too close to the zone of the compact AV node.
Exactly.
So we do the same.
This is very important. We have to emphasize that safety is really important. There is one more question. If we can repeat again this trick, if we have time, so maybe you can again try to explain for one participant what we mean with this K sign.
The K sign. When you do the, we come back to the K sign. When you do the Benkebach point, you stimulate the atrium and you look for the ventricle. At very close to the zone before the Benkebach point, you can see that your stimulus comes before the past ventricle. And if you measure the interval, the AA interval, and the ventricle-ventricle interval, you can see that you have achieved a PR interval greater than the subsequent RR interval. What mean? That the conduction on these times is all through a slow pathway, a very, very slow conduction. I'm not so sure to be clear. If you can help me, Joseph, you can do that.
And then there is another question. Should we stop ablation on appearance of fast junctional rhythm during ablation?
Yes, absolutely. If you have a fast junctional rhythm, more than 130 beats per minute, it's better to stop. Another point, it's better to do ablation not during isopreterenol, because if you have a very high sinusal rhythm, you can cover the junctional rhythm, and so you can well interpret acutely your ablation.
Okay, there is one more question. Can you discuss on a variant of AVNRT with eccentric retrograde atrial activation and how you approach this entity? this eccentric retrograde
eccentric, what do you mean eccentric? Left side. In some patients, you find very few patients. That's happened 1-2 times for years. You can achieve your good results, and you have to move in the left part. In this case, generally, we perform not a retrograde approach, but a transeptal puncture, so we can achieve better the zone, the same zone of tricuspid, of mitral ring in this case, at the same level of posterior mid-septal zone, and we do both anatomical and slow potential guided ablation. In this case, you can be guided by the presence of Johnson arrhythm.
Yes, I think that's a very good answer. We would do the same. We also have a couple of patients where we had to go transeptal and do it from the other side, but that's not very frequent, I think.
So the conclusions, if you want, we have to remember that AV in RT is the most common supraventricular arrhythmia. It's a benign arrhythmia. With the ECG, we can pose the correct diagnosis in the majority of our patients. The substrate is the presence of dual AV node physiology, and that is also present in large percentage of the general population. Acute treatment is based not only in ablation but also in vagal maneuvers and adenosine for acute treatment. Long-term management is dependent on the choice of patients. Radio frequency is the most effective cure for this kind of arrhythmia, but in selected patients, and it means very young people, or some patients with a long PR interval at the baseline, or with a very small Cox triangle, the cryoenergy can be used also if it increases the percentage of recurrences. And I want, there is not yet the guidelines of ESC say the same. We can stop with the recommendation for long-term treatment of patients with the recurrent AVNRT. So you can see, if are poorly tolerated AVNRT, ablation is considered like class 1 level B of evidence. If the patient is very symptomatic for recurrent AVNRT, still catheter ablation is class 1 level B. In AVNRT with infrequent episode, but is the day zero of patients, catheter ablation is still one level of evidence B. And the same is for vagal maneuver when the AVNRT is well tolerated.
Yes, well, I think we should finish. We are a bit over time. So first of all, I would like to thank to Fiorenzo Gaeta for this nice, recapitulation of all this knowledge and development of treatment of AVNRT. As you could see, Fiorenzo focused on the most common SVT, that is AVNRT, and it's very important because this is arrhythmia that we can treat very successfully, but it's also very benign arrhythmia, and we always have to weigh in individual patients' benefit and risk. And it's now more frequent than WPW, which is in developed EP countries a rare species, or it's before extinction almost. And if I can give one last comment for all this ablation of AVNRT, I would remind you our proverb, which is measure twice, cut once. So if you are not sure or if you feel that there is a risk, please don't ablate to avoid AV block, which is a disaster for young patients, for instance, with this benign, relatively benign arrhythmia that is just a symptomatic. So if you have some variant that you are not sure what you are doing, please don't ablate. And this is the most important message from me for all of you. And I hope that you enjoyed the webinar. And I would like to thank Fiorenzo. I would like to thank to the ERA team for giving us this opportunity. And I wish you all a very nice evening. Bye-bye.
Thank you very much. Bye.